Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a big round of applause for our angel of the morning, Merrily Rush. Where were you born?
I was born in Seattle, Washington. I'm a native.
All this time.
I'm proud of
it.
Yeah.
Give her a hand.
Thank you.
And you
I liked it in the state, but Seattle was a little town back then. It was, you know,
really.
It was no L.A.
There was no Space Needle.
No, there was no Space Needle. It was just, you know, and I grew up in the North End in Lake Forest Park, but my grandfather's farm was in Redmond, and I spent a lot of time there, and now I live there. It's my farm.
You're on a farm.
My life is spent in great anticipation, but it's a hopeless situation.
When was the first time, though, that you decided to have a band or to get into rock and roll, if you will?
Well, I would go to USO shows and I'd play my classical music, and then I would back up these friends of mine who sang, and they would get all the attention. So I decided I better start learning how to sing. So I had all this musical training, but I never took voice lessons. So at some point, Neil Rush had a band called The Aztecs. And this is in 1960, and he needed some background singers for a recording, and so I went with my friends and did the audition, but he hired me, and I joined that band, and after I joined that band, all the musicians quit. So then we started a band called Merrily and Her Men, and we played an old place. I know it's not there anymore, but a place called the Seven Cedars. And there was a great rhythm and blues period going on at that time. And so we were asked to join a group called Tiny Tony and the Statics. Just a fabulous, fun group with Tiny Tony Smith, who was 300 pounds of twist. And so I played keyboard and sang, and I sat down at the keyboards, the Wurlitzer. I played the Wurlitzer.
You recorded, I believe, Angel in the Morning in 1968, correct?
Yes, 1968. It turned out that I recorded it in 68. I went down earlier because I was on a tour with Paul Revere and the Raiders. I was an opening act. And they were doing their Going to Memphis album in Memphis, and they did a tour of the Deep South. So when they wound up that tour, they went back to Memphis to finish up the album, and I was there. So I went into the studio and just did a demo for the producer, Chips Moman. And he liked, you know, the uniqueness of my voice. So a month later, in January, I went back. He had a friend of his from April Blackwood bring me a tune called Angel of the Morning, which had already been recorded by Evie Sands, a very good friend of the writer, Chip Taylor. Gosh, when I heard it, I went, if people listen to this lyric, they're really going to want to hear it again. And it was a song, it was the same chord progression as Wild Thing or Louie Louie. It's the same chord progression when you get to the chorus. But the lyric so revolutionary for its time.
It's very catchy. It's a catchy, I mean, really, it's a catchy song.
It's a catchy song, but the lyric was the important thing about that song, because female singers had not talked about what was talked about in this song and said so poetically.
And what was happening with the turnabouts at that time? I mean, was that gone and over, or did they record?
No. The Turnabout started in 1965, and we were going strong, playing Teenage Dances.
Right.
And at that point, it was 1967, at the end of 1967, when I just went out on tour with Paul. And then in 1968, the top of 1968, I recorded Angel and the B-side and went back to work, you know, just came back up here and continued working.
So the group, in effect, never did really record behind you?
No. It's on the record, but they weren't there.
Well, that's interesting. And
here's the great thing. The guys that were on that track were they cut many, many, many hits. They cut the 36 sides on Elvis at the end of Elvis's career. They brought back Neil Diamond with Sweet Caroline. They did Son of a Preacher Man. And you can hear it's a very unique sound that they had that was only true to them. They sounded like nobody else. And so we picked Reach Out, the Four Tops Reach Out, and did a psychedelic version of Reach Out.
So Angel is, I don't think I've heard of another song that has gone around to so many different people. Isn't that a little unheard of?
Well, actually, they just digitalized it so you could download it. It hasn't been digitalized until just now. But my favorite stuff was doing the Teenage Dances. It really was. I loved doing the Teenage Dances. I loved playing for dancing people and just getting to rock out. When I had to go into clubs, it just wasn't, it wasn't the same. It wasn't as much fun. But the periods, Marilyn or Man, it was a pop band. Doing stuff like It Will Stand and that early 60s. And then from there to Tiny Tony and the Statics, purely rhythm and blues. And that stuff came from a station. We didn't listen to KGR for that stuff. We had our own little FM tuners that we would get a station called KZAM on, and we would pick up the rhythm and blues from that. We were getting it from that station. And then the Beatles came along and pretty much killed rhythm and blues everywhere. And we had to regroup. And so we started a group called Marilyn and the Turnabouts, which was pop. It was just pop. That band was the best chemistry I've ever experienced. It just came together. And so we did pop. We tried to infuse R&B with the rock, and that went on all through we still do some rhythm and blues, but but we were doing English, you know, the English and the mod stuff and psychedelic, and until 1969, it was coming to a close. The Teenage Dances were coming to a close. I went to Vegas and did my first Vegas show, and Joe Gersio, who conducted and arranged for Elvis, did my first show. And so I went into Vegas and hated it, because you're doing three shows a night, you're doing the same material every show. You can't deviate from it because it's all arranged. So I hated that really quick. And then I came back to Seattle, and the Teenage Dances had died. So we had nowhere to go but into the clubs. And the clubs were fun. A lot of them were fun because some of them were big rock rooms where we got to play loud and play for dancing people.
There was a point where the recording companies decided you were not going to do rock and roll, I guess. Did I get that right? Or, I mean, they had you...
Well, the producers. The producers are the ones who decide the concept. And Chip Smoman, who cut Angel, they just decided that I had a sweet voice, so they made me sing sweet.
Okay. Well, you do have a sweet voice.
Well.
Yeah.
That's one side of me.
Right? If you could live your life all over again, is there anything that you would change at all?
No. No.
That's it.
No, because everything that we go through, for a reason, and it's part of, it's just part of the lesson. My happiest time, my happy place is in a dog show ring. Running around a dog show ring with a great, fabulous dog is so exciting. And when you win, did I mention that, winning? I've had Old English Sheepdogs for 47 years, and this is what I do. I love to show and breed.
You've won some ribbons in that, haven't you?
Yes. Many champions.
Okay.
Many champions. Basically, I don't go to dog shows every week because I want to have a life. Unfortunately, this is a passion that I've had all my life. And this is my husband and I, Billy Mack, a really good sport when it comes to the animals. Because he's an artist in his own right, and he's a city boy from New Orleans, and I brought him up here, and he's had to become a country boy, so.
In 2003, weren't you recorded on a PBS program with Fabian and some other?
Yes, I was, and Jan and Dean, just before Jan died, and the Orlons, and Bobby V, who I've worked with quite a bit. Everybody loves Bobby V. And there was some surfer acts on that.
I'd like to go back to the time that you were on the Dick Clark Bandstand. And in those days, whenever a celebrity came out, they would lip sync their record. And because in those days, they didn't have bands. You know, you couldn't
not
band it. So you lip synced it. I'd like to go back and do that. What do you think, audience? It'll make us all feel like teenagers.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mary Lee Rush.
There'll be no strings to bind your hands, not if my love can bind your heart. And there's no need take a stand, for it was I who chose to start. I see no reason to take me home. I'm old enough to face the dawn. Just call me Angel of the Morning. Light will be dim, and it won't matter anyhow. If morning's echo says we've sinned, well, it was what I wanted now. And if we're victims of the night, I won't be blinded by the light. Just call me Angel of the Morning. Angel.